He came to the fore as a hardcore dancehall toaster and member of Bounty Killers Alliance in 2005 and was made a household name with this breakout hit. It wasn't long before Signal was received and celebrated as one of dancehall's luminaries. But behind the number one hits, the touring, the campaigns, the fame, was a man haunted by his past. We're rising to the top. But while fans the world over celebrated the persona of his Signal, we honor Devon Gordon, the young man behind that character, as we now know, had a deep secret. I miss a let peace reign for all mankind. Man tired of the war and crime. In 2002, before he was established as a recording artist, Gordon was arrested in the United States on drug-related charges, but soon absconded bail and headed to Jamaica. So we now go to jail again. Oh, no. In May of this year, after 10 years as a FBI fugitive, Signal was extradited to the U.S. to face absconding charges. But after just 5 months in a Minnesota jail, Busy was released on November 16, and on that same day took the first flight he could get home to Jamaica. So me say, if you ever been to jail before, you have to keep an eye open even if you a snore. Still basking in the joy of freedom, Busy Signal joins us right now, right here on stage, with the first lady in his life, Velma Gordon, his mom. Welcome, welcome.
This is good.
So nice to have you. Busy.
Respect.
Good to see you, sir, in the flesh.
It's been a long while.
Yes,
it's been a long while.
But yeah. Something you say since your release, you know, that the 5 months, you know, feels like 10 years behind the eyes. Talk about that. Explain that.
You know what, for me, it wasn't just an easy street or an easy walkover. Some people may have it as a vacation, you know, them have that. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody's different. For me, you know, I got my life, my career was going, it's still going. I mean, you know, everything afloat, you know? And bam, from the airport to gun court to GP, extradition to America.
So it was very tough?
Very physically and mentally. I never see myself nowhere near Jamaica, nowhere near this year, next year, next year, next year. Living in America as a youth and just getting in trouble for the first time. My mother never knew how to deal with it. Mm-hmm. Me never knew how to deal with it. You know, I say, she finds some money and see a lawyer. Online say, him can take care of the problem and this and he know how to sort it out. Because yes, your son got bail, that means so we can go to trial.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, go back for me and talk about the 10 years. What was it like for you? Take us to the beginning of this 10-year period.
That 10 years for me was really painful. Mm-hmm. It was heart-rending. You know, every day I was so despondent to know that it was like, I have a son that I cannot be close to. I cannot do what I'm supposed to do because, mm-hmm. you know, signing that bond mm-hmm. and for him to leave the country and go away, it was like, I have to really be careful whatever I do because it was like the family was in prison because we could not contact him the way that we want to. Mm-hmm. And stuff like that. So I know that for an attorney for us to really choose an attorney online, that wasn't the safest thing to do. Mm-hmm. But the attorney in our state claimed that it was too far away.
What state was this?
Connecticut. I live in Connecticut, mm-hmm. and it occurred in Minneapolis, Minnesota, which was like a distance like Jamaica from Connecticut.
So, and you were there for how long at that time, in 2002? How long were you in the U.S. for?
I was in the U.S. for about 4 years.
Four years?
Yes, when the incident occurred.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Go on.
So during that time, it didn't work out with that attorney. He was just forcing him to sign a, as if he was guilty for the crime, and he decided that he wasn't gonna sign that he was guilty, and that was where it all broke down.
That's when you decided to run, Lizzie?
That's right. When I decided to, me have a step. You know, cause my mom meet this attorney online, and I mean, you know, him say, yeah, we're going to trial. I got bail on this stuff. I wasn't there. I didn't have narcotics in my possession.
Yes.
You know, I didn't. The transcript in terms of the phone call, you know, that was taped, wiretap and everything, mm-hmm. phone tapping, and the transcript was there. Me not have nothing to do with the cocaine, whatever them catch the youth with, because it was the other youth who get caught with some cocaine and everything and end up calling my phone. You know? So okay. It was that the transcript was there. So, well, go on, where are you? So you have the money, me say money for what? Everything. So, me, I say, which money? What are you deal with? So all these things was translated in English so it can be in front of the court. So that's the reason why I got bail. And he would never got bail. So me got bail. Me, I say, okay, I mean, you know, at least the judge sees it.
So the case, you had a very strong case.
Very.
The case against you was very weak.
The case, right. I mean, it was very weak in
so
terms of that
did,
side.
So why did this, for me, this lawyer want you to sign that you're guilty?
Just want to get it over with. Because, you know, me a black man, me a little youth, and yeah, mm-hmm. me supposed to be guilty. Because something like that, and I mean, in getting money already, my mom paid that money. You know, mm-hmm. I couldn't do nothing at the time. You know, I was just a kid living with my parents. And I mean, you know, him getting money and everything, when I get there to the hotel, the day before court, we over there in Minneapolis, the day before court, present me with a plea bargain.
Yes.
He sign away my life for 5 to 7 years, you know, saying I'm guilty. When the transcript and everything say, me not have nothing to do with it, that's why me even get bail in the first place. So, him now just want an easy thing for me to sign say me guilty and him just to take him money and me just gone to jail and him lost me. Okay. And then now him gone with my mother money. Seeing? Mm-hmm. And me just in a jail, it wouldn't be a busy signal. So him say, all right, sign the guilty this and that, and I say, eh, give me some time to think about it. And him say, okay, man, I'll go crash him, I'll get some lunch or whatever, and I leave with at the hotel. My mother in a different room, me in my room, mm-hmm. have this paper with my life on it. And a pen put on side of it.
Okay.
And I say, eh, step out.
And you didn't tell your mom that you're going to
run? I can't tell you that. I dads and the boss, this, you know, I can't get pan for your nerves at the time.
So you took it on yourself?
With my decision.
So how did you get back to Jamaica? What did you do when you, how did you get back here?
Because some woman just fled, I just know, say, you know, my country is from my barn and grow. Mm. Now I go back, I'm not approach back, you know, at the time when I was not approach USA. I just stay out of the USA. I just a boom, I'm, you know, train, bus and everything, and we and we get to something, and we move, and airport and Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing? And I say, all right then. My mother don't know all of that in she don't, yes. She don't know nothing about it, because I just leave.
You just disappear?
Disappear, I just leave. Because, I mean, I can't sign away my life knowing that
yes.
I'm not guilty of this stuff.
So what went through your mind when you couldn't find him, when he disappeared?
My blood pressure was elevated. I was so sick. I was very worried, thinking now that, oh my God, if he's caught, it's gonna be worst. And I'm gonna be in this, you know, it's gonna be real terrible for us. So I was really, you know, I was really, really stressed out with all of this. But at the same time, I have strong faith in God. And I said, you know, God is able. He specializes in the things that seem impossible. So I leave it in his hands and only praying and fasting and putting it up to him to take charge.
Mm.
Government was calling my home phone, checking, do you know where he was? You know, we were being harassed and all of that for about the whole case. They came to the house to search to see if he was there and stuff like that. So it wasn't an easy time for us.
Mm-hmm. So you must have got some relief when you heard that he was in Jamaica, right?
Yes, I did, but you know, I still could not contact him.
Okay.
But
that he was alive and
right.
All right. We're going to take a break right here. When we come back right here on stage, we're going to be talking about her bringing up Busy in This World. He's great. Welcome back. We are talking with Busy Signal and mom, Velma Gordon, right here on stage. Now, Mrs. Gordon, talk to me about raising Busy in St. Anne, in Brownstown, it was?
Lorbox and St. Anne. It really wasn't easy. When I had my second child, my husband went away to the United States. He went on farm working, and he did not return. You know, people go, they run off the track, and he did not return. He said he wanted a better life for us, and he was going to try to make a way. So he did not return. I did not see him for about 8 years before he came back. Yeah. So growing up with these boys, it was really difficult for me because I had to play both roles in the home.
How many boys?
Three boys. That was where Busy really fit in. You know, he had to play a big role in the family to mentor the other
ones that were younger.
And yes, because of that, all of them learned to cook, to clean, to sew, to wash, to do everything. He was the one who was supposed to see to it that things were done, and you know, and they definitely listened to him because the younger ones respect him very much.
So he was a good kid?
Yes, he was. He was a good kid. Mm-hmm. He was, as a matter of fact, he used to cry so easily, even more than the other boys.
He was a softie?
Soft-hearted person. Mm. Yes, very helpful.
Went to church?
Oh, Lord. They all had to go to church. They all had to go to church. They perform in church. As a matter of fact, we usually do quartet together, the three boys and myself. And sometimes three of them would go up to perform. So that was where it all started.
Yes.
They practiced to go up and to do things before huge crowd. Mm-hmm. So he was used to performing before people.
Were you, did you ever see him as an artist at that time? Did you see him as becoming a recording star?
I knew definitely that something was really there.
Something was gonna happen.
Yes. Because sometimes even around the dinner table at home, he would be drumming all the way. Sometimes I even have to throw things at him and say, boy, stop the noise at my ears. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes it got so annoying. I would get complaint from the school that he used to attend. It was the same thing they said. He would be tapping on the benches and stuff like that because he was born with such musical talent. So he did, I really knew that there was something there beyond, you know, when that part of it, I knew that there would have to be something because he would be, the least little chance he get, he would be imitating somebody like Bounty Killer. He would be Lord of Mercy and stuff like that he would be doing all the time. You know, and
so were you annoyed by this? Disappointed in him? Did you encourage him? What was your position?
Well,
on this?
My position was I really wanted him to be in the church because I was born and grown there. My father was a pastor. I wasn't really exposed to the worldly life. I've never been to a club from I was born. I'm so used to the church and the spiritual aspect of life.
Okay.
So I knew he had the talent, likewise the other boys, because the youngest one, when he touches a guitar, it's like it's talking words. Mm-hmm. We are from a talented family. So I knew then that something would be going on, but I wanted them to be in the church.
But whatever it was that he was on to, mm-hmm. or was happening in his head, mm-hmm. was too compelling for you.
Right.
You were losing him.
Right, because you know, he in the long run, I know that he was going to make his decision. He wouldn't be a kid forever, and as he grows older, I know that he would make his decision.
How concerned were you, though, that he was, and he sounded, if he was doing Bounty Killer, then He was aiming for dancehall. Mm-hmm. How concerned were you?
Well, I was very concerned in that I believe that if he takes that direction, then it would be more difficult for him to come to church. You know, so I was thinking that if he's not going to make gospel music, then he's going to be far out in the world, and it's going to be so hard for him to come back to church.
So Busy, why were you, what made you want to resist the gospel?
I guess it was just a youthful thing, you know? Mm-hmm. My mom is a Christian, we were born in a Christian home, we grew up like that and everything. My grandfather passed, and it's real strict, you know? It's real, we go to church and
Too strict, maybe?
Like tree strict. we go to church on Sabbaths, and I mean, from Friday sunset, you know, you have to start. This is church start, Sabbath 7 day start from Friday sunset to Sabbath Saturday sunset. Yes. So it's like a real strict. So when we hear, I mean, we as a little youth know, we hear the dance them a keep and the song them a play, and but we inside of the house a Bible study and everything, you know. And we love God, we know God, we know everything about that and everything. But you know, the young mind's still a pine after.
Stray.
Car.
Distracted by the
hear the
bounty
killer, then I hear the ninja man, then I hear the super cat, then I hear the shabba. And it's like, me, I listen to these things and I love them. You know? I love music overall, but you know, we are listening to the something them and we love them because we are saying, yeah, this now are the youthful something.
Yes.
The church thing is very good. I love church music. I did gospel songs, well, since, you know, Busy Signal. But at the end of the day, we love dancehall, you know. So it's like, I was just
urging. So when did you do the ultimate now? And break your mom's heart and run out of the house or whatever you did to become the artist you are.
It get to a point which, as you say, you know, we'll be kids forever. It get to a point when mommy stopped beating me. Mommy stopped beating me now. You know what I mean? I'm the eldest of the brothers, and she stopped beating me. She kind of gave me a little break in certain things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she won't. We go to church on Saturdays and everything, but if we don't get the night, maybe if me beg her and cry and make up my face and go with a bag of thing, she will say, she will not feel bad to beat me. Because they say, them time, them cry, because it's emotional about what I want. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's like, you know, she would have given me a break sometime. I could have got DJ up on a sound, okay. Win some little thing, win Guinness and them something. We couldn't even drink the Guinness, them. We win alcohol, we couldn't do them something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we stand up with there on the people, them. Her fear was yeah, you know, you got there on the smoking thing, you got there on the this, you got, you know, enough things fall out.
So you were trying to reason with her and to tell her that you were cool.
Yeah, man.
That you wanted this real bad.
Yeah, because we are talk. Mm-hmm. We are talk now. It reached to a level which part. That's me say, me get enough beaten, enough box.
Mm-hmm. From and it's them, still not work.
From
so,
them, and yeah.
So mom is that reason with you now?
It reached a level which part we can reason. She cry, me cry.
Oh.
Yeah, that okay. Type of reasoning there. I'm a big son this. You have to help me with the smaller brothers, car, this and that and everything in terms of personal family stuff. That's why up to this day, no tattoo.
Yes.
Can't touch my skin. My ears no bore. Them certain things become a grower like that. And me no need it. Me act without it. You know, this is Busy Signal. My born at from. You understand? So it's like, me no need additional.
Me no need
additional fake stuff.
See
it? Yeah, me just need, me have me little, you know, and me just keep it like that.
Okay. Just talk to me real quick now about that big move now. How did you get to Kingston and when did you decide that music is I'm going to be a dancehall artist?
Here is the lab. No matter which part I come from in Jamaica, Kingston is one of the real place which part I can come do the production.
Okay.
Yeah. And I say, yo, I forget to this place. I can me want the music and everything. Mom want me to do gospel. Yes, me I go do gospel, but me just want to have me little chance as a youth to make a little decision for myself and do music. Mm-hmm. Come to Kingston as a little youth, you know, and stay so and live with my auntie and, you know, me stay so and do music. And at the time, it was just immature stuff. Because in my head, me ready, but me not ready. So, I observe more.
Mm-hmm.
Between them time, the filing workout, father.
Okay.
We have to migrate. The whole family have to migrate.
He became legal in the US.
And was now...
Ready
to take you up.
Filing came through, everything.
Mom and the entire family?
Yep, mom and the entire family, green card.
Same?
Permanent resident, USA. I arrive LaGuardia, and then now when we drive, when my father bring and drive, we go Connecticut. The morning after that, me dey on a radio station. Me no know nobody, me no know what to do, me no know what to sing, say.
Really?
Me dey on a radio station. Yeah. In Hartford, Connecticut, a local radio station in Hartford, Connecticut, yeah. A man named Scott, my father knew a man named Scott, Patrick Stevenson.
And just threw it in there.
Him just a boom and him bring me a radio station and said, DJ. At the time, I think it was Jaworks with Terra Fabulous. You know? Yeah. And I may try DJ on that rhythm there. Jaworks with him. From them down there. Never that said much, never. But I was just eager. You know what I mean? I just want to go after my dream, no matter which part of the end of the world.
Same.
Yeah.
I'm going to take another break right here, Busy. When we come back, you want to tell me now how that move now to the Alliance, when you met the Alliance, how did you become a member of the Alliance?
Yeah.
And I want to hear from your mom, how she feel about that, about when you were gone for so long, what was going through her mind, how worried was she? When we come back, right here on stage. Welcome back. We're still talking with Busy Signal and Mom, right here on stage. Now, Busy, the Alliance.
Yep.
When did that come? How?
You know, live a foreign, their own sound. I try to, you know, try to be a disc jockey and I try, you know, select it. It worked, you know, and everything are going good. It was a youth named Jeffrey Spencer. From Riverton, me and him a real friend. You know, he's passed away, you know, and everything, condolences and everything. But Jeffrey Spencer introduced me to Bounty Killer while Bounty Killer was abroad doing shows and everything.
Okay.
And Jeffrey said, Killer, that youth, yeah, serious. And him always, more time people see him and I wonder if I you, because I mean, the black, him just up in the black and him just, the long up mouth and the glasses. So people are, you have to meet that youth, that you John Wim, them call him, them time. At the time, me did name Hype Up, because I was just being a DJ, playing sound, you know.
Selector.
Yeah, selector and everything as well, yeah. So, Jeffrey met me meet Killer. Killer just, like instantly Killer just respect the person. Killer just respect the way of me deal with my thing, as a liquor youth at the time. Yeah, and Killer just, for that reason, Killer even give me some dub. Killer even give me some dub them time there. Ha! Hype Up! Me have them dub there right now, same way put up. Me and Killer roll. We got mall, we got different place and everything. Them time, them man, me not really know, cause me not really, even though we're there, I mean, I'm still young. You know, me not really tell mommy them sitting there, cause mommy know, you know, she got a dance all this, you know.
She looks like she's hearing these things for the first. The first time,
A dancehall role in this, and people think about dancehall like it's a rough situation, or we know it's a rough situation, but it's definitely not a rough situation, at least not for everybody.
Okay.
Yeah, you see, and so it's like me know my mother got think about them something there already, cause me know.
So
them
you were always conscious of the impact.
Yeah.
Of your behavior on your mom, right?
Definitely.
So you were cautious. Were you very cautious?
Very
what
cautious.
You're doing so that you don't hurt her?
Very back. Cautious. I mean, in terms of the stepping, that's why I'm trying to try.
Yes.
Up to present moment, Wilfred.
How worried were you?
Well, I was worried in a sense that listening to music and listening to how artists react sometimes among each other, and how competitive it is.
Yes.
I was really worried at times, you know, what could happen between them. But as Busy said a while ago, according to that moral that was instilled into him from childhood coming up, then I was really thinking to myself that he would know how to behave and how to operate out there among all these other artists.
Okay, so those values that you instilled in him.
Right.
But growing up, you were confident that they could keep him.
Exactly.
Settled.
Right.
Walking the right walk.
Right.
Did you ever support him in his musical career?
Well, I've never been to any of the shows. I've never been there at the actual, you know, thing that he's doing. But I communicate with him and, you know, try to encourage him as to how to operate and the type of music that I would be interested to hear.
Okay.
I do not like those music that are selective, that, you know, that only certain people could be listening to. I believe that good music is something that, whether you're a Christian or you are somebody in the world, you should be able to listen. That's why I love Bob Marley's music, and people like Marcia Griffiths and people like those who make certain music that anyone can put in their vehicle and listen to.
Okay.
So that is really...
And you express that to him?
Yes, that is really what I would like him, because although Bob Marley's music was, I mean, people would really call it gospel, but the morals that are there, you can really take home those things that he really portray. And so I would really like my son to follow his footsteps.
So now I know. Now we know why. You started out in the Alliance, hardcore busy signal, looking for the attention, looking for the bus. But gradually, you shifted gradually into more of what your mom is talking about.
Yeah.
In terms of your output, in your content.
Definitely.
And I thought, I thought I was linking that to your predicament with the U.S. government.
Yeah.
And now I know that it was deeper, that because you wanted to please your mom.
It's
now that you were busy signal the superstar after 2005, when you got that step out hit.
Yep.
You can now take some risk and become more of who your mom wanted you to be.
Yep.
Am I correct?
Definitely.
So, while you were a fugitive, it wasn't because you wanted to impress the world and the FBI why you switched to the kind of music, but the deeper reason is your mom, right?
It's a level of, right now, may I say, all right, this is busy signal. You know, the artist is not just a dancehall artist. I'm not just in the box, you know, it's not just a little matches box with everybody pile up like the matches stick them. I think outside the box, I try to do different stuff. I know I got the talent, and I'm confident that I could try different stuff. I could be creative.
Yes.
You know, so I use this creativity now. I try to sing. Instead of being hardcore all the time, I still do hardcore stuff, but instead of being hardcore all the time, I try to sing some stuff. I try to make it more conscious. I try to make stuff. And then now, at the end of the day, I start, you know, getting kids and stuff. So me, I see. Was she did a try to make me see, cause I am her son.
Okay.
No, me have my kids them, and me, I said, you know, say I know everything me sing say, them beat me I can't listen to.
Mm-hmm.
So me try balance it.
Okay.
In terms of the creativity, you know, me try to sing some stuff, put it in my own words. You know, you have the One More Night, you have the Night Shift, you have the El Shaddai, we sing the Christian song. You know, me say, the one of the first CD me give my mother, plus my grandmother.
Do you have a favorite from him?
Yes, I do love the praise and worship song.
Mm-hmm.
That it's like gospel music to me.
Okay.
I do love that song very much.
Mm-hmm. Any of the others, the other secular ones? Night Shift, for example.
Yes, I do love Night Shift too.
Yeah.
Yes, I do. I do love. There are certain songs that are really not like, praise and worship, but still words are in there. Even this latest album here, I love it dearly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even when he was in jail, I could relate to him while I was communicating with him. Some of those same words in those songs, like. Things getting crucial and some lock up in jail, you know, and stuff like that. And, you don't always get what you want and the way you want things to flow. That's part of life. I know all those songs too. I maybe don't go there and sing them, but I know them all because I listen to them. My other sons play them more time, and I usually sing by heart. So I know the words.
Okay.
So that album is really an excellent album, and that's very good music that anyone can.
But isn't that your best work? Is it to date? Would you say is that your best work to date?
My best reggae work.
reggae
because
one.
You still can't mix it with, you know, it's still a Jamaica genre music, yeah. but it's a different part of music in terms of we got a rich culture here musically. Mm-hmm. You know, we have ska, we have reggae, we have
and
dance.
And you're embracing the entire spectrum.
I'm embracing it. I'm trying to spread my wings.
Okay.
You know, there is no limit. So I'm trying to spread my wings, do it. And I mean, it's my best work yet in terms of the quality, in terms of sales, in terms of you know, the magnitude that it puts. Mm-hmm. Reggae music again, that album.
All right.
Yep.
Living as a fugitive. The arrest and the conditions Busy endured behind bars, and alone pulling and performing for over 60,000 in Gambia, and more. Big artists in Africa. We'll talk about that when we come back. And we're back with Busy and Mom right here on stage. Now, Busy, talk to me a little bit about the relationship right now with the Alliance.
Yeah.
Do you still have a relationship with that?
Alliance for Life.
You're still Alliance?
Alliance for Life.
How is Killer?
Very good, very well. As me land, as me just a boom and step out of the airport, I kill her that on the phone.
Yes.
See, I'm a chat to kill her on Shane's phone.
Yes.
You know, me I say, we fly down on the plane on American Airlines, me and Elephant sit next beside you. I mean, we sit beside each other and everything. Elephant was crying, Elephant was so emotional. Oh, yeah. In just a, yo, here was this, more and more things. Me I celebrate my friend Dust Flop. More and things, more. I'm just, I mean, me and Elephant, we just have so much fun on the plane.
Oh,
it's like,
yeah.
it was just so, you know, at that moment, you know what, somebody, my God, the judge, see, the judge look in my life, the judge look for my record, the judge look for my do, and as a result of that, I'm here. I'm just grateful to be here, grateful, glory be to God.
Killer tells me, right here on stage that you were almost happy to be caught, to be facing this.
Forget it over.
My words, but explain that for me.
Forget it over with, Will.
Yes.
Since 2002 to the last 6 months ago whenever the beginning of all of this happened.
Yes.
I'm a walking prison. Mm-hmm. I've been in prison in my mind. I've been in prison mentally all that time.
You know, that's what I thought you meant when you say the 5 months was like 10 years.
It's like a decade of imprisonment.
I suspected because you were very low-key.
Very. Yeah, man, I'm a stay subwoman. It's like me in a prison in my mind for a long time. So no matter how, it's a busy smile, I would do the interview, them, I would perform live and everything. That's my job. I do it. I love it. But at the end of the day, when I go home, when me I walk, sometimes when there is studio, just take a break. It there's never a day go by when me I say, hey, you know, say I go there today. Yes. See? And we know what go on in terms of everything what happened in Jamaica. We see the news, we see everything. You know, me I say, before me the other day, the last person a private jet come from extradite. You know, me I say, 23 years. Mm-hmm. Fear drive into me. I knew all of this all along.
Buju and Ten.
Me and Killer dep on tour of Europe. Me, Killer, Richie Spice. I mean, you know, Queen Afrika, Anthony. We was all there on tour and everything. The last song me sing on the last, you know, the last venue before me come off of the stage is Nagua Jail again in Amsterdam. Mm-hmm. And we left Amsterdam, me and Shane, figure in transit through London, you know, fi come back to Jamaica the Monday. So we leave Amsterdam the Thursday, we stay over in London, get back on the plane, come back to Jamaica the Monday. When we arrive at border agency, immigration, put under the book, good morning, you know, take the book and everything. You just see two of the British border patrol immigration officers or feds or whoever you that terms it. Them are forward and them say, Mr. Gordon, step this way. And take me out of the line. And bring me in our room and put a paper on the desk with a picture of me and information. He said, Mr. Gordon, is that you? I said, yes. Well, the US got a hold on you. You left a case pending and, you know, we ran some checks and, you know, we got a call saying, you know, we got a hold on you. We're not going to deport you. We normally what we do is send you back where you're coming from, which is you just
came in from Amsterdam, we should send you back to Amsterdam, but you're a Jamaican citizen. We're gonna have to send you to Jamaica, but we're gonna have to hold you here in the airport. We're not gonna let you in a London. Mm-hmm. We are holding you here in the airport till your flight Monday. And we'll just send you back to Jamaica.
How were you treated during that time?
I was there in a holding. It's like, it's not really a jail, mm-hmm. but it was like a holding, which part, them hold you near the airport and you're there till your flight where they leave. So like a short term stuff. So I'm there and them hold on to my passport and them hold on to my stuff and everything. Shane gone, I cry and some bag of thing.
And we must tell our viewers that Shane is your manager.
Yeah, management.
Right.
See?
Okay.
And I mean, it was just, I'm just there like, okay, this is it, but gotta go put me through this. Cause I'm the young them time, the my record and my lifestyle I'm have right now is not that something. Me never get in trouble, me never get arrested prior to the 2002 case. I will never get arrested are in trouble after the 2000 case,
yes.
till up to now.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing? And then now me, I say, you know what? Gotta go help me through this. You know, see Basia, she bring me to church, you know, for her my grandfather, which is her father, she passed away, him passed away, right, you know, times ago and stuff. And me just believe in her God and know, say, yeah, something good must come out of this car. Them say, good will follow you when you do good. I'm gonna get myself in a trouble and pass and mix up from long time.
How do you compare the that time you spent in GP, in Jamaica?
Yeah.
How do you compare the facilities, the US facility?
Yeah.
And the Jamaican facility? What's your comparison?
6 or 1.5 dozen at the other. Because you are going to know, you see me the GP, because I boom, reach Jamaica, them carry me go gun court.
Mm-hmm.
See, the gun court for liquor days and stuff, you know, represent, we get to a lawyer, Mr. Knight, and stay, so boom, we go halfway through, go court, then them, after we have rights and everything, them transfer we to GP. When I'm the GP now, the first time I go in, they put me in a cell with 3 or 4, about 3 youth. You know, small something, woven thing, bakery. And I said, what is that? I don't need this, I'm not used to that something. You know, the cell them have in the bathroom.
Mm.
So if you want to do that something there, no bathroom no, in the cell after the door them lock.
Mm-hmm.
So you go do what you do, or if emergency in the night, them still not open the door, if you go ready certain way, you have to just use your bathroom, and me, I said, yo, me no, you know that something. So, me there, I said, the first night, and then they said, okay, detainees who are there, I'm not a prisoner of Jamaica, I'm not in the Jamaicans, I'm just like in transit in there,
yes.
Basically. For US, I wait for the US to come to me. Mm. So, in the middle of the night, somewhere down there, them come move me out of the cell with the other youth, them, and then put me in a single cell. Single cell, Wilford, full of chink.
Mm.
They think them feed palm me, them fat, them bust.
Oh.
The whole of the something I have on a white t-shirt. When we wake up in the morning, the white t-shirt like is like a beer laser beam a pine palm me. There's a red spot on the white t-shirt. The way all the chink them feed off of me. Seeing?
How do you compare them, that with the American thing? Is it different?
So,
is it better?
You want to know that the Jamaica now, the chink them and the bag of thing them and the cell situation, no bar to another cell. But at the end of the day, you can cook your own food at GP. Seeing? You can do certain things. You can get food from your family and your friends outside of the world. That's Jamaica. US facility now. I was in a maximum facility. Me no see outside, me no see the light a day.
Oh, really?
Seeing? You no get to see light a day. You come out 1 hour, you beard, you make your phone call, you go back in, lock in for 23 hours. Seeing? Not even my aunt's care in a USA cell. Bathroom in your cell.
Everything have to clean all the time.
Everything have to clean all the time because them response for you and people can't.
So your biggest problem was that you were in isolation, you were in maximum.
Maximum.
And not able to see out.
I'm the biggest thing, not even the maximum, because me is not a people person. Mm-hmm. From long time, from man. I'm not talky, I'm not talkative, certain way. So it's like, you have a thing called my diet. I eat certain things, I don't eat certain things. So the food system, it mash me up. The chlorine and the water mash up my ear. Ear have to cut off will for it. Give a quick glimpse.
Yeah.
Seeing busy with the artist hairstyle in the whole world, and everybody know, and like we have met this. Seeing everybody know that. I have to cut off the ear, the chlorine strong in the water, it mash up, damage my ear. The food was there, you see my body, how it look. Seeing? My mother cry, my brother them cry, Shane cry. You know, I say, elephant man cry, bounty killer weep.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people who love with them weep. Even when we land at the airport, the immigration officers cry. You know, people who outside, I mean, I will never announce it. People just, it was just so, because this is busy signal an artist or represent and walk a certain line,
yeah.
That unexpected line as a dancehall artist. See? So the food system, you can't get no food from no visitors, no, nobody can visit and get no food.
And then now you have to eat what them give you. You have to wear what them give you. Me no matter. But the clothes them go on in the laundry, but you don't know who it did depend when you have to wear it.
This begs the question about why you waived your rights for a hearing in the Jamaica. Is it a hearing in Jamaica? Why did you waive those rights and go directly to the US?
Yeah. I know what, I mean, the charge was failure to appear. Mm-hmm. You know, the PSI, when I get there, the PSI, you know, which means the pre-sentencing investigation over there with the federal agents and the court and everything, the pre-sentence investigation, you know, they do the whole investigation from the original charge and everything and dismissed it. So the new charge was just failure to appear.
Okay.
So Mr. Knight, you know, Mr. Cady Knight, you know, people know the star boy, the real man, everything.
Star boy,
him give me the legal advice. Him come in and me sell a half a tree. Him say, you know what the thing go?
Mm-hmm.
Glasses down and nose pint. Mr. Gordon, the best thing that you can do for yourself and the best thing that I can do for you is telling you to waive your rights. See? And him say, that are the best thing. Him know about this thing, extradition thing and everything. The charge is failure to appear. It don't make sense. I fight when I can't fight. Mr. Knight look upon me and look. Like him just look upon me as a son. And him say, you know, some lawyer would have milk you and squeeze out everything out of your nose. Say, yeah, you know. Yeah, at the end of the day, US is coming for you. Mr. Knight, treat me right, him treat me to the level, him just shed the light and all of me that I fear.
And you have no regrets about None. Taking that route. And the judge is very impressed with your work for the last 10 years that you...
Cady Knight was the one who interviewed and chose the lawyer that I have over there in America, which was Bill Marzi. I have to say, big up Bill Marzi, one of the best lawyers there, okay. You know, in Minnesota, Minneapolis. And it's like, the judge look at my life. My lawyer over there, you know, came to Jamaica. We never really load it up. When I come to Jamaica and get a DVD with different stuff, fax and video and DVD, show it to the judge. The federal judge have access to the internet. I'm there, I'm still saying I'm gone and I'm look for my life. Busy signal never miss a flight. Since me an artist, me never miss a flight.
Okay.
Me never do not show up for a person show, take them money and owe them and not give them back and no refund and them something.
Okay.
Me never been arrested prior to 2002, January 12th.
Mm-hmm.
Never been arrested after that.
Mm-hmm.
Nowhere in the world. Him check my file. Me go Canada, go to shows multiple times. Seeing, me never try drive from Canada to US illegally, entering the USA side. Me go Japan, me go England, me go Africa, me go Belize, me go different places. Even Belize, you can drive from Belize to USA.
Okay.
And I never take those routes.
So you know all of these things counted?
All of these things counted. Look for me on the RE school tour. You know what I'm saying? Look for me when I perform for the campaign for Kamala, which is now the Prime Minister of Trinidad.
Mm-hmm.
The election, the election there was the Monday. She called me to come perform the Friday and the Saturday. Election campaign, perform for people with the people of them and everybody thing. So, they, you know, she have to choose her artist because this is election.
Mm-hmm.
It can have a backlash on her being a candidate to run for prime minister. She won the election the Monday. The judge said, I perform in a Gambia, 60,000 people.
Yes.
Busy signal alone upon the show.
Talk about that real quick, because I must commend your mom for the values we're playing out there, all of that.
Yeah.
Never miss a flight, don't take money on a show. All of these things, we're going to credit mommy for that, you know.
At the boss.
Yes, man. Those values.
Mommy don't want to beat none of them.
Coming up, a message from Mrs. Gordon to mothers. Busy alone pulling and performing for over 60,000 in Gambia and more. Gambia now. Talk about Gambia. 60,000 people for Busy Signal in Gambia. How did that come about? Did you know before going that you were that big down there in Gambia?
Never knew. There is one more night. Let me give you one more night. Smiling cost a million. Them link management and I say, all right, them are keep a show. Busy is the only artist what them want from the show. So right there, that spark and interest right there. Like, one artist from the show. busy signal, like right now you can't really call me a full dancehall artist, you can't call me a full reggae artist either. Mm-hmm. You have to just say artist. Because mm-hmm. we perform with a wide range of things. As I said earlier, we spread our wings in music.
Yes.
Them do them thing, finalize, you know, with contract and everything, start out, band members with rehearse and everything. Reach upon the style, and I see the airport and the welcome. People them rush come with soldiers, you know, them fatigue and everything. Come take me off of the plane. Move with, it's like a, what I'm calling already, a convoy. Mm-hmm. I don't read it, right? Yeah, because sometimes it's bright and brilliant. And God. But may I say, Wilfred, me stay so you want to see the line and the way of the welcome. So me start, I'm not scared, you know, but I don't know, I got something there.
Yeah.
I see them people, I say, oh my God, me alone upon this show, you know. You see the billboard, them, you see everything. Them, I say, them, I can't go to the president yard of Gambia, which is yard, the president of Gambia.
All of this you didn't expect?
Me never expect this coming day. I know I see this. And them have been in some tough van, you know, the thing set up. See, now people are shaking it, busy, be. Them have to have soldiers, not police. Them have to have army fatigue with rifle and not for murder people.
Busy.
Just for secure.
Oh my goodness.
The musical asset.
And is that the only place in Africa you went to?
No, I went to Gambia, you know, came back to Jamaica and everything. Then I go to Kenya, everything, and then we go to, I think it was
So
Ghana.
Were the others as big as the Gambia parents?
The Gambia appearance was the biggest one.
Mrs. Gordon, we have a message for moms out there in Jamaica whose children are busy with boys.
Yes, I do have a message for them. Sometimes we tend to force our kids into things, and we believe that if they really don't make it to college, they are done. There's no hope for them because you want them to go to college and they didn't have the brain or they didn't go. So, you know, you don't have anything to do with them. But my message to them is that never you put a child down or believe that there's no hope. Mm-hmm. If that child doesn't make it to college. Because I have three sons, as I said earlier, and the other two, they went through college. Busy really didn't go to college, but they are not better off than Busy today. I'm really so proud of him, of what he achieved, and he only been to the high school level, got his diploma. So never you doubt, and if anybody listens to him, I usually listen to your interviews when we usually get them abroad. Mm-hmm. And he usually do some really interesting interviews. You could never know that he never been to college.
Very bright.
So,
very bright.
You know, it's not for us to really put doubts on our kids and think they cannot make it if they did not really reach that level of education.
All right.
Busy. But we must always encourage them.
Must. Busy, sir. When? Is there a first there must be an appearance in Jamaica now, in the works. When?
There's so much thing pending right now. Yes. I tell you it for, like,
it's gonna happen before the year is up.
Some people talk about booking. Mm-hmm. Right now, booking wouldn't even be the right word, because booking can't hold the amount of booking you need.
Okay. it's just, worldwide.
It's just so people just await and anticipate. Them want everybody, and everybody want the first. Mm-hmm. You know? So it's like so many things pending, so many things, nothing really confirmed yet, because, you know, everybody I try to draft up them things, I try to draft, even from the figure point of view.
Yes.
You know, just to the level which part them want to put it to, because it's not just any little place.
Okay.
Them want to deal it and them want to make sure it's.
Because all of this happened quite suddenly.
Quite sudden.
Yeah, so I understand. All right, so I need to ask you this. How does all of this impact your ability to travel? I know that you won't be able to go to the US for a while. I think you have the judge, that kind judge, wants you to come back in 2 years.
To try again for a visa in 2 years.
The probation
allows us in term that it was 2 years probation and stuff. Mm-hmm. If I'm in the US, the probation kick in.
Okay.
But we can still apply from now. So we have meetings. We're gonna have to set up meetings and stuff to apply from now to get it in place.
So chances are you could get back in the US before that.
Very big chances.
What about the UK and Canada and the rest of the world, Europe and so on?
I think Ms. Galata, the Italian consulate lady here, Ms. Galata, she represents for me there in terms of all the Europe stuff. Everything is clear, you know, to go out.
So you can be in Europe next year?
Yeah, I wasn't convicted of a narcotic. I wasn't convicted of a drug charge or a drug crime. Mm-hmm. You know, so she worked it out and everything. So we have meetings, setting up meetings right now. Management setting up meeting with the U.S. and trying to set up meeting with British and Canadian embassies.
Okay.
So it's like we just trying to get all this on the grounds because I'm just so anticipating to go out there, see the fans perform for them, not for them here, but the support. You know, people who signed the petition, which part would I try to say, if we didn't need the petition and everything, even though we never needed that at last, I'm still grateful. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm still thank God and still thank the fans, you know, for support and everything. And all the people who pray for me and the whole of the Christian, them who really got up on their knee and fast and pray for me and everything. And it's just a wide love, what show, what we just, you know, sometimes some people say something and some people would laugh. I say, yeah, you know, the good way you follow you and everything. I say, man, hey, come here, I do good so long I nothing happen. It's like sometimes me is a living proof. You know, we have a testimony. I have to sing some gospel song by, I think, them supposed to release by this weekend or something. Me not studio since Monday. You know, I say, we go to a doctor today, I'll know there's something still up and them do blood tests, them make sure, say,
yeah, right.
Ready back for the thing. I'm busy this and the thing not lame, the thing have to electrify.
Well?
Yeah.
Busy, this is a marathon, this interview, so I want to thank you and Mommy.
Blessing.
Mrs. Gordon, thank you so much for coming and sharing.
Just let her mother lap you and come in and I eat that thing.
Of course. Yeah, there you see it. Love, lots of love right here on stage.
Parents cook and everything, me soon put on back little body. and some stuff. And everything good. Big up the ladies, them. Big up the youth, them. You up now. The violence and crime and the something them, we don't need that something there.
Mm-hmm.
Music for people enjoy themselves. Yeah, big up all the selectors who support. You know, me can't start calling name. Mm-hmm. You know what I say? Big up on stage. Media in the maximum facility, federal prison. And me talk to my mother tell me, say, I saw Winford Williams show on stage and Shabba Rankin. Big you up. I'm in a jail, I go back in my cell and I cry. I've never met Shabba Rankin in person. I've never talked to him on a phone from the band.
We need to collect some money from somebody. The show's all over the world.
Big up.
It is pirated all over the world, but we're making it official.
Big up.
But right now, we want to take time out to big up all the people watching us in Canada. They are seeing us for the first time, by the way. 4 million homes in Canada right now watching us. Thank you for coming on board. You'll be hearing so much more about this show on stage. I'm Winford Williams on behalf of all of us. Thanking you for joining us. Do join us again next week